do what you have to do.
Thank you.
I don't know of late, they have a system of putting lights on the ground. You actually blind them. So therefore you come from there, easily identified.
Shri Anand Vohra, President IIC, Mrs. Usha Vohra, Trustees of IIC, Honorable Justice Nariman, ladies and gentlemen, I extend a warm welcome to you for today's lecture. This lecture is held every year on 14th January in the memory of the founder president of IIC, Dr. C.D. Deshmukh, as his birth anniversary falls on this day. The first lecture in this series was held in 1983. For the last 35 years, this has been a very important day in the annual calendar of IIC and is very keenly awaited by our very discerning members. In the past, these lectures have been delivered by persons of eminence and erudition, such as L.K. Jha, Dr. Karan Singh, Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, Malcolm Adiseshia, Dr. Srimati Kapila Vatsayan, B.G. Verghese, Bimal Jalan, and also Shri Vohra, our president. And to this pantheon, a pantheon of colossi, intellectual colossi, who have all spoken at this occasion, today we add another name, that of Honorable Justice Rohinton Nariman. I now request our president, Shri Vohra, to please say a few words.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. As you just heard, the director has given us a brief background of this evening's lecture. Dr. Deshmukh was our founder president of this institution. Today is his birthday. So we've been celebrating, recalling his memory and also celebrating his birthday by having a lecture from an eminent personality speak on an important subject. Today we welcome Justice Rohinton Nariman, who is well known to all of us. Many of us have not met him earlier like me, but I've known about him. And many of us here in the room today, in the auditorium, we have known his dear father, who's been one of our very old senior members. What Justice Nariman is going to speak about, he himself will tell you, because it's a little enigmatic, but from what little I understand from the topic and the little two-line blurb under the notice which we circulated, he is reviving memory of the contributions and the ideologies of the philosopher kings of the years gone by and correlating it to the contemporary modern-day constitutional concepts, ideologies of dignity of the citizen, unity, integrity of the country, the precept about minority rights, fraternity, and then take us back in time, talk about it. So I will not say anything further. Justice Nariman was educated in Bombay, Delhi, Harvard Law School. He practiced for some time in Harvard, in New York, and he has more than 3 decades of legal practice in India. At a very young age, he was named senior advocate by the then Chief Justice. When the minimum eligible age was 45, he was 37 when he became senior advocate. He was Solicitor General of the country, and 2.5 years ago, he got inducted to the apex court, where he is and will be for several more years. I find it relevant to mention that 500 of his Supreme Court judgments are reported and well referred to. amongst his non-juridical interests, he's interested in Western classical music, history, religion, comparative religion, and has been lecturing quite extensively, including at our center. 10 years ago, he spoke here. So this evening, he's going to deliver the Deshmukh Memorial Lecture. I welcome him once again and invite him to speak to us. Thank you.
President Vohra, Mr. Verma, other dignitaries, ladies and gentlemen, let me begin where I left off 10 years ago. In this very hall, I delivered a lecture on the great Austro-German composer Beethoven. And let me tell you, the hall was as packed as it is today. It was a longish lecture. It took about an hour and a half. I don't propose to detain you that long today. But what is interesting is that the Almighty, when he showers us with his blessings, does it in clusters. Where Western classical music is concerned, for example, you have Bach, Handel, Scarlatti, all extremely exalted names. All born not only in the same period, but the same year, 1685. You have Verdi and Wagner, the two greatest geniuses of opera, also born in the same year, 1813. And you have the great geniuses like the subject on which I spoke, preceded by even greater geniuses like Haydn and Mozart, and all together. The 5th century BC was another remarkable century because you had not only great thinkers here in India and great philosophers. You had the Buddha, you had Mahavir. In China, you had Lao Tzu, you had Confucius. And in Greece, you had Socrates, Plato, Aristotle, all at the same time. Plato, in his book 6 of the Republic, spoke of a utopian city, Callipolis, which would be ruled by a utopian philosopher king. The utopian philosopher king, in fact, came about during the great age of the Antonines. Now, the Antonines were rulers of Rome almost 2,000 years ago. And they followed upon Emperor Augustus, who was one of the great emperors, who then was followed by complete lunatics like Tiberius, for example, who used to rule from Capri instead of Rome because he was a surly sort of chap and took great pleasure in throwing people off cliffs. Then you had an even greater lunatic, Caligula, after him, who was a great nephew of the great Augustus, who in his short rule of 3 years stunned the world and left it having made a horse a senator, Incitatus. After Caligula, you had one other great gentleman, Nero, who, as all of us know, fiddled while Rome burned and did many fantastic things, such as have his own mother put to death, the very mother who brought him to power. And he kicked his pregnant wife, Poppaea, so that he caused her death as well, and then had some young boy who looked somewhat like Poppaea to follow him in remorse. Now, following these utter lunatics, you had a reasonably stable rule by Vespasian, who was the general who then came up and took over, followed by his two sons, Titus and Domitian. Titus is very famous because you have that arch in the forum, which shows, among other things, a huge thing which was taken from the Jerusalem temple, which he destroyed completely. And ultimately, given this misrule, the people were so sick that they appointed a man called Nerva, who was an old senator, who ruled for only about a year. But the most important thing that he did was to see that his son did not succeed him. The person he named was a person called Trajan, who was a Spanish soldier, who was again a brilliant ruler, and the kind of philosopher king that was spoken about by Plato. Among other things, he conquered what was Dacia in those days, which is modern-day Romania, and established what was called the Pax Romana, which is the Roman peace. And according to Will Durant, this is perhaps the period in history where people were best governed by philosopher kings. Because one after the other, they appointed the best person to succeed them. It was most fortunate that none of them had children. So that the net result was that Trajan appointed Hadrian, who was another extremely great emperor. You hear of Hadrian's Wall up in England. And Hadrian in turn appointed Antoninus Pius, who in turn appointed two emperors, Verus and Marcus Aurelius, the latter of whom is perhaps the most famous philosopher king of the entire lot. His book, Meditations Written on the Danube, is something worth reading. It's a brilliant philosophical treatise by a Stoic. But unfortunately with him, this beautiful period in history disappeared forever because his son Commodus took over. And in fact, Commodus's rule was a misrule of the type that had gone earlier. So much so that after Commodus, when a gentleman called Pertinax came to the throne, the Praetorian Guard actually set up the entire Roman Empire for sale. And it was sold for so many million sesterces to some gentleman called Julianus. Fortunately for Rome, and for the then civilized world, Julianus's reign lasted some 90 days, not commensurate with the huge amount that he had paid, and was then followed by Septimius Severus, another great general who took over. Now, the importance of the philosopher king is that a ruler, when he is merely a ruler, does not carry the entirety of his people with him. A philosopher king, on the other hand, carries the entirety of his people with him. And the subject chosen for today is three great contemporaries. Why do I say great? Historians, after each of their rules, have dubbed each of these people great. Akbar, incidentally, means great anyway, and he was an amazing personality. He was exactly contemporaneous with Elizabeth I of England, who was also called great. And Suleiman the Magnificent, who was the 10th in the line of Ottoman rulers from 1300 onwards, was also called the Magnificent, something even greater than the great, by the Western world. But incidentally, by the Muslim world, he was called Suleiman the Lawgiver. And he was also a contemporary, but an older contemporary. He ruled from 1520 to 1566. Akbar's rule started in 1565 and ended in 1605. And Elizabeth's rule was coterminous, almost exactly with Akbar's, ending in 1603. Now, the important thing about the lives of each of these people, which I will briefly tell you about, because each was an amazing character, is to tell you how and why they were called great. They carried the entirety of their people with them. Akbar was, as all of you know, the third in a very illustrious dynasty which ruled this country for about 250 years, the Mughal dynasty. Mughal is really a corruption of Mongol, because they all came from the steppes in Central Asia. And Babur, the first of the Mughals, actually traced his lineage back to both Tamerlane as well as Genghis Khan. And Babur, when he came and attacked Ibrahim Lodi, the then ruler of Delhi, in Panipat, ultimately succeeded because he had matchlock, he had firearms, as opposed to Ibrahim Lodi, and set up unwittingly a dynastic rule here. He lasted for only about 5 years. Incidentally, Babur is an honorific. Their names, their personal names were all different, save and except Aurangzeb, because Aurangzeb the sixth, and one of the really great ones, was an emperor who somehow or the other was known by his name and not by his honorific, which is Alamgir. And Alamgir, incidentally, is exactly the same in meaning as Jahangir, which is odd, because Aurangzeb was a person who denigrated his grandfather Jahangir by calling him that atheist. Now, Babur, which means tiger, his actual name was Zahiruddin, was a person who came here, set up the dynasty. Humayun then ruled after him. Humayun gave his father a promise that he will not, or in fact will look after, positively look after his brothers. His brothers kept rebelling against them and he kept looking after them, instead of looking after the empire. And very shortly, a very able Afghan ruler, Sher Shah Suri, took over, and Humayun got expelled. While Humayun was on the run and on his way to Persia, our hero was born in 1542 at a place called Umarkot in Sindh. He was a precocious child. It is said that he smiled at birth, something like our great prophet Zarathustra was supposed to have laughed at birth. His great aunt, Babur's sister, when she saw the baby, said, "This is exactly my brother. His legs are the same, his get-up is the same." And indeed, he was even greater than his grandfather. He was a person who was utterly fearless and both physically and mentally completely extraordinary. Physically, apparently, he is supposed to have actually slain a tigress with cubs. And he is supposed to have entered an elephant fight and separated the two elephants, the fighting elephants. The animal world somehow took to him, he took to the animal world. He had a favorite leopard, which was called Madan, something or the other, which had a drum beater before it. It was given such importance. He had a favorite elephant called Hindal, whose grave you see at Fatehpur Sikri, which is a grave with elephant tusks sticking out of it. This remarkable man was larger than life. And his utter fearlessness translated itself into everyday action. He was a man who basically came to the throne at age 13 because his father fell down a series of steps which you will see here at the fort which was at that time called Din Panna, which is our Purana Killa. And while the muezzin called out for the prayer, he missed his foot and fell and hit his head. This boy was only 13 years old and somewhere in the Punjab, Bairam Khan, the trusted general, went running to him. And for almost 2 weeks, because the father died on 26 January, 1556, this boy was proclaimed king at Kalanaur in Punjab. The place is still kept there. And till then, to see that there'd be no disruption in the succession, they had to act as if Humayun was still alive. So a person called Bunla Bekazi would come out on the balcony and greet everybody and tell them the emperor is getting better. The moment Emperor Akbar was crowned at age 13 at Kalanaur, The first thing that he had to do was face a famine, a huge famine. And the second thing that he had to do was to face a person called Hemu. Now, Hemu was a person of Banya birth who apparently filled the power vacuum when Humayun was forcibly ejected from India. And the great Sher Shah Suri ruled for about 10 years. But then his children and brothers, etc., were not up to it. As a result of which, Hemu became extremely powerful and took over both Delhi and Agra. And the first thing that the young emperor had to do was to assert himself over Hemu. And this is where the second battle of Panipat took place in the year 1556. And the battle was going very well for Hemu, as a matter of fact. When unfortunately, like King Harold in the Battle of Hastings in 1066, an arrow went and hit Hemu's eye. Hemu slipped and fell from his elephant. And Emperor Akbar was called to do the coup de grace as a young man of 13, which he refused to do, by the way. And ultimately, Bairam Khan hacked his head off. And it is at that point that Mughal rule was really established in this country. Bairam Khan continued to rule as regent till the young man turned 18. At 18, he decided to send the general off to Makkah. The general complied to begin with, rebelled thereafter. There was a battle at Jalandhar. And ultimately, the general was sent off and on his way got murdered at Patan in Gujarat. Akbar, as this young exuberant 18-year-old, then established not only rule in Delhi, he had, by the way, 144 rebellions against him. Not a single one was successful. And having established his rule at Delhi, then went on to conquest after conquest of Rajasthan. First it was Malwa, then it was Bihar, then it was Chittorgarh in 1568. If you people go to Chittorgarh today, you will see the place where three Johars took place. Now a Johar is an immolation, a massive immolation of the women of the community when they realize that there is no hope and a conqueror is going to seize them. The first took place when Alauddin Khilji besieged it in 1303. The second when Bahadur Shah of Gujarat besieged it in 1535. And finally, the last one was Akbar's in 1568. After that, fort after fort fell. Ranthambore fell next. And ultimately, not only by conquest, but by marriage, Akbar actually saw to it that Rajasthan and large parts of North India became his. He extended his territory to Gujarat in 1572, in commemoration of which he built that great Buland Darwaza, which you see at Fatehpur Sikri, which is the great fort that Akbar built. And thereafter, he somehow or the other managed to conquer the entire Northwest India because of rebellions from his half-brother, Mirza Hakim. Now, all this conquest was not without purpose. The object was not to come here and be a robber baron and run out with the wealth of this country. The object was to somehow settle here and rule the nation, the entirety of the nation, as beneficently as possible. And this is where we come to his great Ibadat Khana, which was really the first council of world religions. This was set up in Fatehpur Sikri. Some think that it was probably in the Diwan-e-Khas, which is pointed out to us when we are tourists. And it is remarkable that people of every faith and hue actually visited there and disputed with others or spoke about their faiths, all of which the emperor drank up. Incidentally, the emperor as a child was so playful, nobody could make him read or write. But he was so erudite and his memory so good that he could correct somebody and say that you said this on such and such day, on this particular day, and now you are saying the present. So you can't possibly be correct. And he listened to all this, and having listened to all this, imbibed the wisdom of every great world religion. Charvaksvendar, the materialist school here, who did not believe in anything beyond existence. Sabiansvendar, a Sabian, incidentally, is a Yemenis monotheist. And they are mentioned in the Quran as being people of the book, along with Jews and Christians. Jews, of course, went there. The Christians had three great Jesuit missions, all sent to Akbar's court. First was headed by a priest called Father Cabral. The second had the gentle Rudolf Acquaviva and Father Montserrat. And the third was by Jerome Xavier, who was the nephew or grand-nephew of the great Francis Xavier, whose body lies in Bom Jesu in Goa. Each of these missions was in order to attempt to convert the emperor. But the emperor stood steadfast. He said, I accept everything. I accept that Christ was born of a miracle. But I do not accept a trinity. He had big problems with the trinity. And I do not accept that there is anything like a son of God. So, it is at this that he failed to become a Christian. And interestingly enough, he sent the Christian fathers to train his sons. And in particular, one son, Daniel, who unfortunately ultimately turned out to be an alcoholic and died early. But he had great reverence for every faith. One of the faiths for which he had tremendous reverence was mine. A Dasturji called Mayarji Rana, who we call Merji Rana, went from one of our cities in Gujarat, Navsari. And somehow or the other impressed the emperor enormously. So much so that he put on a sadra and a kasti onto him, which is something that we wear as emblems of our faith. And having put on this sadra and kasti, declared that the emperor was now a Zoroastrian. The emperor, incidentally, was so slippery that he became everything, but then ultimately became nothing, and stuck to what he wanted to, what his philosophy was. And sun worship entered, fire worship entered, the Persian calendar entered as a result of Mayarji Rana. Another person who impressed him enormously was a person called Hir Vijaya Suri, who was a Jain monk, a great Jain saint. And this great Jain saint, somehow or the other, impressed upon him the importance of having a faith like Akhenaten's in Egypt, where the emperor threw over all the earlier gods and goddesses and concentrated on one particular god, and hence is called the first monotheist. But that god was the disk of the sun, Aten. And these were ideas that were given to him, apart from the obvious Jain ideas of non-killing, etc., which greatly impressed Akbar. He was also greatly taken up by a Sufi sect called Tajuddin, and ultimately decided in the interest of this nation that he should form a new religion by himself, which he called the Din-e-Hilai, which idea, as I told you, he got from the Jain Muni. And the reason why this religion did not ever take root in this country and died with him was because, even though it was highly evolved, highly spiritual, there was no priesthood, there was therefore no ritual, no custom. Above all, you did not have to abjure your old faith to enter this faith. The only thing you had to do was to bow in obeisance to the emperor. The faith had many good things in it, such as the removal of sati, such as the removal of killing of infants, particularly female infants, etc., etc. But ultimately, though the idea was good, and though the idea was really to bind the nation into knowing and loving one another, it died with this great emperor. The emperor was so great that the Muslim Maulvis, who used to despise him because of his open-mindedness, ultimately issued what was called the infallibility decree in 1579, which, based on a verse of the Quran, said that if a person like this is so learned and so brilliant, we will take our spiritual guidance from him. Ultimately, Akbar died a disillusioned man. His mother, who was only 15 years older than him and who he was extremely devoted to, died 1 year before he did. And ultimately, when you see his tomb at Sikandra, you realize what a great man this was, because the tomb itself is made in so many different styles. He is buried there. But in 1691, the Jats did something amazing. They came and they desecrated the tomb. They pulled out his bones and burned them. A Hindu funeral, after all, to the great emperor. We now come to the second great of our talk, Suleiman the Magnificent. Suleiman, as I told you, was the 10th ruler of a dynasty which ruled for 600 years, beginning with 1300 AD and ending with the First World War. This man had as his great-grandfather Muhammad the Conqueror, who did two very important things. One was, at age 21, to actually take Byzantium, which was Constantinople. How he took it is a great story in itself, told beautifully by Stefan Zweig. I don't know if any of you have read Stefan Zweig. And one of the beautiful books that he has written is called The Tide of Fortune. The second story is the fall of Byzantium, which narrates in detail how this young man took something which stood as a bulwark against everybody for 1,000 years. He also decreed, and this was very important for the Ottoman Empire, that it was imperative on every new ruler to completely destroy any other rival claimant to the throne. Because if he didn't do so, you would have civil war. And this was followed to a T until one Ahmad the First, in the 1600s, early 1600s, decided that he didn't wish to destroy his brothers, cousins, etc., but that he put them in what is called the cage. And the result was that these people proliferated in that cage. And finally, when it was found that a particular Ottoman ruler had no direct descendant to rule, some donkey would be pulled out of the cage. And as a result, you had people like Ibrahim, who was a sultan, who was so crazy that he rivaled Caligula, in that he would dress up as a horse and go neighing into his harem, who he would dress as mares. And you had rulers like this, which ultimately made Turkey the sick man of Europe. So the Ottoman dynasty was extremely well served until poor Ahmad came. And Ahmad, being a clement ruler, laid this rule down in preference to that of the great Muhammad the Conqueror. Suleiman himself was born of Selim the First. He was called Selim the Grim. He was grim because he followed to a T what his grandfather Muhammad the Conqueror had preached and destroyed everything and more before coming to the throne. Suleiman, on the other hand, was lucky. He had no brothers to destroy. So when he came to the throne, again at the tender age of 25, he was a liberal philosopher prince. Again, like Akbar, he was a great conqueror. In the year of the first battle of Panipat, 1526, he conquered Hungary, Battle of Mohacs. He conquered Belgrade before that, which his great-grandfather could not do. He knocked at the doors of Vienna twice. Once he was repulsed by the weather, the second time by the great Emperor Charles V, the Holy Roman Emperor. And an interesting conquest was the conquest of the island of Rhodes, because Rhodes at that time had what was called the Knights of St. John on it. And after he conquered Rhodes, he went himself to meet the Grand Master of the Knights. The Grand Master was an old man. So he kneeled before him and he said, I am so sorry to have to evict you from here in your old age. And looked after. Malta was the one place he faltered and was not able to conquer. But his greatness is in being called Suleiman the lawgiver. He was called Suleiman Kanuni. And his kanun lasted for 300 years after him. It was liberal. Punishments were reduced. Jews and Christians were treated extremely well in his realm because they were the minorities. And this ruler was loved. The one great blot in his career was that he married this Circassian slave called Roxelana. Now, he was so besotted by this woman, he produced four children from her, that she somehow or the other made him put to death his older son Mustafa, who was extremely well suited to succeed him. So Mustafa was called bowstring, because in those days you strangle people with a bowstring, by his father. And that put him in the company of other terrible rulers like Ivan the Terrible, for example, who actually finished off his son, Ivan. Peter the Great, who did away with his son, Alexei. And Constantine the Great, who was the founder of the early Christian church, who did away with Crispus, because apparently Crispus, his son, was having an affair with his second wife, Fausta. But short of this one great blot, this great man ruled for a very long period, 1520 to 1566. In those days, that was a very long period. And ultimately died on the banks of the Danube. Now again, his son by Roxelana had to succeed him, and he was miles away at the Danube. So for 46 days, his spare body, he had a very thin body, was taken out. The corpse was taken out every evening to review the troops, so that everybody thought that he was still alive, until his son could ultimately take over. This man's reign again teaches us something, and teaches us that a philosopher king is basically one who rules for all his subjects and is loved by all his subjects. The third great ruler now, Elizabeth. Elizabeth belongs to the dynasty of Tudors, who were Welsh. Incidentally, England since 1066 has never been ruled by Englishmen. William the Bastard, or the Conqueror, comes in 1066. He is the bastard son of Robert, Duke of Normandy. And it is Normans who rule and continue to rule in unbroken succession, except for Empress Matilda's son, Henry II. But then again, it is French. And this rule continues right till the Battle of Bosworth, 1485, when Richard III is defeated. Now, Richard III gets defeated by Henry VII, who is the first Tudor monarch. He was born to Edmund Tudor, and this is again very interesting. Though they were Welsh, his grandfather, Owen Tudor, had an affair with Catherine of Valois, who was a queen. She was the wife of Henry V, person who won the Battle of Agincourt. And through that affair, produced two sons, Edmund and Jasper. And Edmund was Henry VII's father. So he could trace himself straight back to a queen of France. Apart from that, to sanctify his own rule, he married Elizabeth of York, after whom our heroine is named. And Elizabeth of York was Edward IV's daughter, the sister, the older sister of those two little princes who were murdered in the Tower by their uncle, Richard III. So, the first thing that happens is, Henry VII rules. He has an older son, Arthur, who gets married to Catherine, who becomes Henry VIII's first wife. And Henry VIII takes over after his father, second ruler of this Tudor dynasty, and rules happily with Queen Catherine until it suddenly enters his head that she was able to produce only a daughter and no sons. And the reason why still sons were being born, according to him, was that God had cursed him. Why had God cursed him? Because his older son, his older brother, sibling, Arthur, was first married to her. And there's a verse in Leviticus, which is one of the books of the Old Testament, which said that thou shalt not sleep with thy brother's wife. Now, despite the fact that his queen made it clear that she had never slept with Arthur, they were children, he thought he was cursed. And as a result, this man, who was a learned man, who was in fact called defender of the faith, he was given this honorific by the Pope, the Catholic Pope, in 1521, decided that he had to somehow or the other get an annulment from this lady and produce a son. He tried very hard with the then Pope, but the then Pope was directly under the control of Emperor Charles V, who happened to be the nephew of his queen. So the Pope did not oblige. What then was the way out? The only way out then was to say that I will become head of the church and I will break away from Rome, which is what he had to do. He did that. He got excommunicated in 1538, became the head of the church, in order to marry Elizabeth's mother, Anne Boleyn. He married Elizabeth's mother, and unfortunately, she again did not produce a son. So he had to find a third wife. And on some trumped up charges, Elizabeth's mother was butchered at Tower Hill. You can see it today when you visit the Tower in London, when Elizabeth was only 3 years old. He then married Jane Seymour, produced a sickly child from her who happened to be a son, and married three times thereafter again. In succession, his wives went in the following way: divorced, beheaded, died, divorced, beheaded, died. Now, little Elizabeth was brought up by very good tutoresses, so much so that she was something like our Justice Shri Krishna, who's with us today. She spoke fluently at least 4 languages. I think Justice Shri Krishna speaks many more. And she was adept not only at French and Italian, but equally adept at Latin and Greek. It is said that at Trinity College, Cambridge, which was founded by her father, there was an address made in Greek, and she answered that address in Greek. So she was a brilliant woman. Of course, she had been bastardized by acts of parliament and then put back. But ultimately, her father left a will in which he realized that his sickly son may not last. So it was important for the peace of the realm, after all, to have a daughter rule as well. And in his will, he ultimately said, after Edward, my daughter Mary, and after Mary, my daughter Elizabeth. Now, Edward ruled for a short period of 6 years and was advised by his advisors, now who had become Protestants, to somehow or the other bastardize his oldest sister Mary, who was Catholic. So, Edward's will knocked Mary out, as a result of which Elizabeth had to be knocked out as well. So all of them went out of the succession. So that when Edward died, a Lady Jane Grey was put on the throne, being Henry VII's great-granddaughter, and she was fished out because she was Protestant. She didn't last. And ultimately, Mary took over. Mary's 5 years were tumultuous and horrible. She was called Bloody Mary because she tried to bring England back to Catholicism. She burnt a lot of people at the stake, including the great Archbishop Cranmer. And her rule set back England in terms of beneficent rule by many years. Seeing this, when Elizabeth succeeded, Elizabeth was very clear that she had to rule over all her subjects, Protestant as well as Catholic. And therefore, despite there being Catholic invasions against her, Catholic plots against her, Catholics were given free rein. This is one very great attribute of this great queen. Another very interesting thing. She was a lady who had very great persons around her and at the time that she ruled. Hers was justly called the Elizabethan age because it was the age of Shakespeare. It was the age of Marlowe, who was murdered at the age of 29. It was the age of the great Sir Francis Bacon, who ultimately landed up as Lord Chancellor. Incidentally, Bacon was another genius who wrote also in Latin. His Advancement of Learning was written in Latin. And Novum Organum, another brilliant philosophical treatise, also written in Latin. This man as Lord Chancellor, unfortunately, was corrupt. And there were, at that point of time, many charges brought against him. But one, in fact, two, by suitors who had bribed him and lost. One was by a person called Egerton, who paid him £400 but lost. And another was some Aubrey, who paid him £100 and lost. And they therefore petitioned Parliament to impeach him. When impeached, he readily said, yes, I did take the £100, I did take the £400, but see, I decided in accordance with law. I decided against them. Ultimately, he was fined £40,000, dethroned, and died quite miserably as a pauper. It was also the age of Sir Walter Raleigh, another very, very great man, who was an explorer who set up the state of Virginia in the United States and called it Virginia after his queen, his virgin queen, brought tobacco back to England, etc. And there were many people like this. There was Sir Francis Drake, who saved the country. Sir Francis Drake, in fact, circumnavigated the globe. And he was the third to do so. The first was a Chinese eunuch called Zheng He, who did this in 1421. 100 years later, Magellan did it and was murdered in the Philippines, after which this gentleman did it. And he was the person who single-handedly destroyed the Spanish Armada. Now, a little more about this. How did the Spanish Armada come, and why did it come to conquer England? This now takes us to another story, the story of Mary, Queen of Scots. Mary, Queen of Scots, was a cousin of Elizabeth. She was a very unfortunate lady. She was married to Catherine the Medici's eldest son, Francis II. Incidentally, Catherine the Medici produced 3 kings of France. Francis died as a young man. She was widowed at 18, and she had to sail back to Scotland. She then went and married a drunk called Henry Darnley. And Henry Darnley Stuart, who was the father of James VI, who ultimately became James I, was murdered by her. She was implicated directly in the plot. After which she married another Scotsman called Bothwell. And after that, she was ejected very quickly from Scotland. She spent 21 years in captivity in Elizabeth's England. And ultimately, when Walsingham, he was the Secretary of State of Queen Elizabeth, came forward and actually gave her a plot by the Catholics, headed by a person called Babington, in which Mary was complicit, Elizabeth had to finally, after a lot of dawdling, sign her death warrant. And as a result of signing her death warrant, Mary was executed in 1587. Now, with Mary's execution comes a Catholic backlash, because don't forget, she was a Catholic queen. And the result was Philip II of Spain sent this massive armada of ships, 132 ships, to invade England. As the invasion began in 1588, this spare little lady went to a place called Tilbury, where she gave a remarkable speech. She said to the troops gathered there that I may be weak and I may have a feminine body, but I have the heart and stomach of a king, no less than the King of England. And she exhorted the troops to go and fight for her. Ultimately, the armada was utterly destroyed by a stratagem used by Sir Francis Drake, which was to send 6 burning vessels into the armada, which caused consternation, and then nature did the rest. Fortunately for England, England survived. Fortunately for Elizabeth, Elizabeth survived. Her last days were not happy. She fancied 2 people in her life. One was Robert Dudley and the other was another Robert. And ultimately, with the execution of the second Robert, she was old, forlorn. And in one of her last speeches made to Parliament, another very great speech, she told Parliament that you may have had many greater rulers than me, but none who have loved you so well, and none who have tried to keep this nation together. Incidentally, she did something remarkable in Northern Ireland. She sent a whole lot of English Protestants to go and settle in Northern Ireland. The idea being that because there were disturbances between Catholics and Protestants, the demographic balance would then be restored and people would be able to live in peace. Imagine her foresight. It is something that Mao did after he came to power in 1949, but with a diabolical motive. Mao Zedong suddenly tells Stalin, sometime in 52, before Stalin died, look, you have huge oil reserves in Siberia. We all need them. Your male population is completely decimated as a result of World War II. We have a massive population in China. Why don't we go work those oil fields and then share the profits? Stalin thought it was a very good idea, until ultimately the Secret Service found out that it was Mao's idea of taking over Siberia for China, because Mao then would have sent young couples who would then proliferate like rats and finally change the demographic population of Siberia so that it became part of China. But Elizabeth had something very different in view. And finally, this great queen dies in 1603 and is followed by James I of Scotland. Now, what do these 3 great rulers exemplify? According to me, they exemplify what is written on Ashoka's Rock Edict 12. Ashoka was one of our greatest emperors. And on Rock Edict 12, what he wrote was, Piya Dasi, he called himself beloved of the gods, has this to say: do not ever extol the virtues of your own sect. You can replace the word sect by religion. And denigrate the sect of others. What you must do is to attempt to extol the virtues of the other sect. And by doing so, you increase the influence of your own sect and you make the other sect loved. By denigrating the other sect, you diminish the influence of your own sect and you make the other sect hated. What is important is concord. What a beautiful word he uses, concord. Every man must know what the other man is about, and thus informed, spread good. I don't think a constitutional lawyer could better put the great quality of fraternity which our constitution has. liberty, equality, fraternity was the cry of the French Revolution, if you remember. Each one of them is in the preamble of our constitution. Reams has been written by our judgments on liberty, on equality, somehow or the other very little on fraternity. And if one is to live today cohesively in this nation, indeed in the world, this cardinal value is of extreme importance. For, in the words of the preamble to our great constitution, what does it lead to? It leads not only to the dignity of the individual, but the unity and integrity of the nation as a whole. Thank you very much.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, I don't think I need to make any further observations. Justice Nariman is patently very erudite historian. He's an ordained priest and he's written a very interesting book in the Inner Fire. I had expected him to speak a little more about comparative religion, but he has said what he has said. And after hearing him and his fantastic memory about historical facts, I would say that he's perhaps using his position in the Supreme Court as a hobby. He could be a known historian, professor anywhere. So with these words, I would like to thank Justice Nariman for having found time to speak to us. And one of these days, I would perhaps invite him again to expatiate a little more on these fraternity and other classical values in our constitutional, perhaps constitutional framework. We do that another day. Thank you, all of you, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you, Justice Nariman. Thank you.